someone at Nintendo has a brain altering stroke that makes them realize how great Linux.
Welcome back to another Linux Gamecast Weekly. The show covers the latest Linux gaming news, reviews, how to's, and most importantly, 2023 choo-choo-choos. I don't know, guys. What do you think? Last one of the year, lads.
It's the end. The end is upon us.
Dude, we've been doing this long enough to where we got that time where like 2012. Yes, here it comes. Save us. Mayan calendar and like nothing came of it. Like, boom.
No.
It was 2021, yeah. Didn't you hear? It was just someone who was dyslexic.
Right. They were like, maybe this time. Anyway, I'm Vin. That is Jordan Svang, joined every week by Pedro Mateus and everyone watching us live, helping us form. Cocaine Voltron, you know him.
Two Cains, Two Furious.
I'd go watch it.
Two Cains, Two Curious.
Yeah, it's about Two Cains, Sam.
It's about a bi-curious toucan and his sexual adventures. Never mind.
Just give me the fucking title, Toucan Sam, and I'm like, I don't care, man. It doesn't even have to have a bird in it. I'm going to go watch it.
It's just Sam Elliott walking around with two canes.
Let's go. Cains Akimbo. Make it happen. What's new? What's going on? Got a reasonably stacked up show, considering like this is the dry time for like gaming, anything, and tech news, because everybody's waiting for CES. Oh, we're just kind of sitting there, but we got some things to talk about. Stick around. Gentlemen, I was injured by an Nvidia card.
As one usually is.
Are you happy now, Linus?
Jensen's jacket has tasted blood, and now it wants more.
In a very roundabout way, I'm working on an attempt at everything all at once for installing Nvidia drivers on Debian 12.
LGC pronounced Bandersnatch.
Yeah. And in order to do that, like you got to throw down. You can't just do this in a VM and with like guesswork. So I set up the test bench and got the 2060 out, plugged it into it, and just spent an entire day, man, like just every scenario I could come up with and just writing down what happened, ways to get out of that and get everything back up and working. While I was doing that, I had to use a regular mouse. Now, typically, I use this guy. I've been using this guy for years. This is the Elcom. Huge. And it's really good. Ergonomic. So I guess this is like a two-part thing. Using that mouse for an entire day here in the studio, just clicking around, doing stuff like that, and wrist hurt like crazy the next 2 days, man. I don't think we realize just how bad a regular mouse is for your wrist.
I mean, like, especially if you're using like a very wrist heavy technique. I've switched to using like a more forearm guided technique, and that helped a lot with like my wrist pain.
And I don't know.
If you stroke from the elbow as opposed from like the wrist.
Like, you know, when I'm rolling dice, but like maybe it's because this one is like designed just to be like hyper ergonomic and stuff like that. And then going back to using that Logitech G2, whatever it was, that really stung. Also, I bought Brussels sprouts. And I don't know where I'm at right now. Did I really want Brussels sprouts, or did I want the smell of Brussels sprouts cooking in the house?
Oh,
we're gonna find out after the show.
we're gonna see how many bags of Brussels sprouts you actually
nom, eat. Nom, 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 nom.
I cannot like Brussels sprouts. They smell like shit.
They smell awesome, dude.
they smell like
stick them in stool.
Green vegetables. You sprinkle a bunch of garlic and salt and pepper on them, and they taste great. Yeah.
No, it smells like toilet. It smells like sewage.
Stay the fuck away from Pedro's.
Yeah, brother. Yeah. Either that or Pedro poops Brussels sprouts.
You never know.
they're small and they're green and they're round. You never know. Yeah.
Yeah. PPPS. You know. Jordan Swang, you survived this morning after fate was like took a swipe at you.
Yeah. Yeah. This morning was spent mostly dry heaving and you know, erupting from my anus as I often do. But I lived. I've been slowly but surely working myself up to like more and more comprehensive solid food.
Trace rounds of food.
Yeah, still very low energy, right? Like haven't really had anything to eat since like until like 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And then I took a nap because I was too tired.
Are you liking that Elgato microarm?
I would if I had the fucking cable. Oh, but okay. I did find there was a little box.
Ooh, do you actually found the screw?
Yeah,
oh, look at you.
It came with two of them actually. The other one is on the other side of the table, and I was gonna grab for it for a visual reference. But yeah, no, it actually did come with one. I'm like, this seems like something that would be included in the box. So right. I went for another dive in there. Yeah. So all that's all.
Peter Mateus, we got to place bets. Will he lose that before?
Now, I have it screwed on the arm, so my odds of me losing it are pretty low.
No.
If it's already screwed in place, all right.
Wait, have you screwed the adapter in that you need?
Yeah.
Oh, what you just held up?
Yeah, I literally just screwed it back in to the thing.
All right, unscrew.
Yeah, if it's already in place.
Yeah, no, because you're like, how long until you lose it? Like, that's a good point. Fuck you, Ben. Screw. What about you, Pedro? How'd you get screwed this week?
I don't think I did.
I'm sorry.
It's, yeah, it's that bit in between Christmas and New Year's that work is relatively quiet. So, yeah, no, it was a restful week, which I very much appreciated. I could have used more sleep, but hey, I guess I'll get that when I'm dead.
Oh, no, you die. It's like, it's a simulation. Walking back, round two.
Oh, shit.
I routinely, it's funny you say that, because I routinely, like, I'm trying to stick up for my support people at work, and I'm like, you do realize that doing this will actually kill your support staff, right? Like, they'll just have brain aneurysms and heart attacks and die. Okay, cool. I just want you to be aware that's what you're doing. Cool. They know it too. They heard you say it. Nice.
I've always liked the theory that, like, straight up, like, if there is any type of reincarnation, everyone throughout time has been given the option of, like, okay, do you want to go back with your memories? And no one has taken that option. I'm like,
Don't need it.
Nope. Don't want to carry that with me. I wish we could talk the horse into that, though. The only animal to constantly come back with all the prior knowledge, death after death.
The horse has been, like, removed from the reincarnation cycle. They're like Raziel from Legacy of Cain. Blood Omen, it's the steam! I swear someone sleeps another Blood Omen game. I really, really like Blood Omen.
It would be nice to actually get a conclusion to the story, but yeah, that was not one of the best games of 2023, unfortunately.
That's what you think.
It is, yeah. it probably was for someone, but not for the Steam top of 2023, as they like to do. They've been doing that for a couple of years now, and this year also has the Steam Deck and the VR categories, so you can see.
I just noticed the controller.
Yeah, the games hell? Played with the controller are the most. You can have top sellers, which they sort by gross revenue, as in how much money people actually spent on the game and in the game. So there's new releases by also gross revenue, most
people
played
are still
as in
buying
peak.
GTA 5.
I don't know. Yeah. I'm trying to scroll down in the controller category to see where I get to a game. I'm like, get out of here. But like, we're already at the bottom of silver, man. Everything tracks. All right, fine.
Yeah.
We got a lot of PlayStation releases this year. So, yeah. Like, mm-hmm. Yeah.
We did.
The thing that surprised me the most was on the Steam Deck one. They have it sorted by like platinum, as in the most played games, and then gold and then silver. And Cyberpunk is on the platinum. There's a lot of people playing Cyberpunk on the Steam Deck.
Yeah,
that's
it's a big game. Like same thing with like Witcher or Elden Ring, right? Like being able to pick it up and like play it in little chunks.
But that's the thing. Like Cyberpunk is first person game, and there's a lot of shooting. So
you will play Cyberpunk with a controller. Yeah, like the with the hacking and the stealth stuff, it's very difficult to do with a keyboard and mouse. I don't that's what I found, at least personally. Like enough of the guns in Cyberpunk have auto aim because like that, like they're smart guns, right? Like that's supposed to be the whole thing.
Okay, so, like, the cheats.
Yeah. But like it's in the game. You go and you buy the smart gun and it, yeah. So, yeah.
I don't know. Is there anything, what was your most played game on the deck this year, Jordan?
I think technically Slay the Spire beat out Baldur's Gate 3 by a little bit, but that's because I was exclusively playing Slay the Spire on the deck, and I was kind of half and halfing Baldur's Gate 3 on the PC versus versus the Steam Deck.
How about you?
Yeah, but
it was a split. I played a lot of Revolt, the radio control car, and Blaze Rush, which is it's that game we threw chairs at a long time ago. It's the racing game that's got like an isometric view, and you control the car by pointing the left analog stick in the direction that you want the car to go, like you're leading it along mm-hmm. with a string. I've been playing a lot of that because that's actually really fun on the deck. And Risk of Rain Returns. Hmm. I've been playing a lot of that recently.
Yeah, a couple of things. I'm really glad to see that we got a dedicated category just for the Steam Deck. That's great. And I don't think anybody's accident. Maybe somebody's accidentally clicked on the VR thing, maybe. Who knows? But there's definitely people playing Counter-Strike on their Steam Deck.
Which Alex is still up there.
It's like, huh. Yes.
Well, I mean, that's the biggest right, VR game currently. So.
That is called sunk cost fallacy, the game right there, man. However, something that I was looking through, like most played, right? 10 years later, guess who's still on this list in early access? Project Zomboid.
Oh,
it's still averaging 40,000 players.
Damn. And
it's still in early access. That game was in early access before early access existed.
Is that game done? Is it basically done? And they're
not
just
if
like,
you still got 40,000 players and you get to say it's early access. So
yeah, mm-hmm. but I mean, like, yes, it's not officially 1.0, but is that game more or less feature complete? And they're just like, oh, we're going to keep on adding new shit. And
I think that's where it's at right now. There's no incentive to 1.0 it. And it is so it's been around after a game's been around for 10 years and it's not out. Like the systems people have developed over that last decade to get into it, like it's very obtuse at this point to get mm-hmm. like you start watching like the background, what people know in order to mechanic wise they know how the engine ticks at this point.
Yeah, it's like a World of Warcraft where like if you want to get into World of Warcraft you need to install like a macro manager because all of the shit is done through the macro manager these days.
Yeah,
so yeah,
you know one thing you can't do through a macro manager?
Winning. I mean, depending on if you're cheating.
Does that look like a man that needs a macro manager?
Yes, it does. He needs to manage some of those macronutrients.
Our next story comes from PC Gamer. All this is going to be in our show notes. Steam keeps on winning. Last year, they all came crawling back to Steam, and this year was another strong one from Valve. And yeah, this is 100% true. In 2023, we had a bunch of people return, a bunch of companies, soulless corporations, return to Steam. Even Blizzard bent that knee. And you know, I was reading through this and I'm like, it's kind of feel good because we're all like, hey man, Steam's pretty cool. We got the Steam Deck and very, very Linux friendly. But you know, the more you think about it, like Steam being such a dominant player isn't necessarily a great thing. But you know, I thought about this afternoon. This afternoon was, unfortunately, you know, Epic, Blizzard, EA, Origin, Ubisoft, they've not been able to replicate Steam's business model of just not dicking over developers and customers whenever possible. They've been this is a very, very difficult business model to replicate, Pedro. I mean, a lot of work and thought and like minute little details of not just
that's
instantly dicking over developers and
that's the thing with Epic. They keep saying that the whole Steam is bad because 30% and that's bad for developers, and they keep on, you know, banging that particular drum, developers, is Steve Ballmer all over again. But what about the users? Do you care about the users? Because we see people, you see Epic doing exclusives on PC.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good idea. And you see people, developers telling, okay, you bought the game on Epic, so add it as a non-Steam shortcut to your Steam library so that you can use Steam input and use your controller with the game. To fucking really? So, yeah, when you have situations like that, it's very hard to lose. Because clearly we've seen the competition that companies like EA and Ubisoft and Epic have been able to bring to the table for how long has Steam been around? 2003, so 20 years.
20 years of this crazy business model, but all of the stores that you just rattled years, off, every single
and
one.
And no one else has been able to. Well, they're clearly able to. They just don't want to. The only thing that they want to compete with is the amount of money that Valve makes. But they don't want to put in the legwork to do fucking anything else.
It's kind of difficult, though, man. Like, whenever every one of these stores was created from the ground up with, like, their mission statement for this was maximize profit.
Yeah.
Yeah, and like you're 100% right. Like if you look at like the development history of Steam, once upon a time it wasn't a store. It was a download manager for Valve games that eventually they're like, "Oh, well you can also buy
and
our
it was
games
universally."
It was shit. And eventually it got to the point where other people wanted to start selling their games on Steam. And like there are valid complaints. 30% can be a little excessive, especially if you're a small developer. That is a large chunk of your revenue that is going to Valve. And maybe you don't like that. And so you get stores like Epic who said, okay, we're going to try to address two of the chief complaints of the Steam store. Developers aren't getting as much money as they could be, and discoverability. And instead of actually solving those problems, what they did is they said they solved these problems and instead started giving away games instead of actually developing the product that people want. And not actually listening to their users, developing like decent user stories and so on and so forth. BattleNet was probably the closest thing because BattleNet was literally just a friends manager for your Blizzard games. Yeah. And that's what it was for the longest time. It never tried to be like a Uplay or a Origin or whatever up until very recently. And then they too quickly realized, hey, yeah, we should probably get everyone on Steam because that's where all the PC games are.
When Microsoft releases, you know, the Microsoft Flight Simulator 2020, they released that on Steam and everyone went, wait, what? Really?
Well, Blizzard Overwatch, man. Like, what
Diablo 4. Oh, Diablo is on Steam now.
And we've been doing this show for over a decade and like, it's easy to root for Valve, but I also see the other side. You know, we got GOG, but GOG has been like, Lex nerds, get away. How'd that work out for you so far? But like, what have we had this entire time? Desura.
And that was a fucking, well, it didn't start off as a scam, but then it became a scam. Maybe it was always a scam and we just never knew.
It just took
they were playing the long game.
Yeah.
It's kind of weird, man. Like, I would like somebody, I want competition for Steam, but nobody's interested in competing with Steam. They're all doing the, you know, we see the same thing happening with like Netflix, right? Everyone wants to bust off and maximize, create their own.
It's the copycat syndrome. Hey, this guy was really successful doing this one thing. We're all going to do the same thing except crappier because we never identified the actual reason why this thing succeeded in the first place.
Well, no. People are only on Steam to buy video games, Jordan.
Yes.
So all we have to do is sell them the games on our store. That way we get all the money and they'll just come flocking over to us.
I got one better for you. We don't even sell them the games. We just give them the games and then we make money somehow.
Yeah, that's what Epic's been training people to do. It's like, why would I buy a game on Epic? I just wait and it'll be free.
Or it'll release on Steam and I can get it there.
Yeah, I buy it on Steam and I get the actual functionality and the community integration and the workshop integration.
I can
play
it on my
deck. And the free Linux port with Proton for the Steam Deck. Yeah.
Yeah.
Moral of the story is CD Projekt Red, we need a GOG boy.
Are they gonna call it like the Geralt deck?
The Geralt deck.
Is it just stubbornness at this point that they just refuse to release Galaxy on Linux? Principle.
Somebody's like, this is never gonna happen.
There's Heroic and Lutris. We don't need to do it anymore. Those guys are fine. Those fuckers will still give us money. So who cares about them?
Yeah, no, clearly they've demonstrated that they can be actively hostile to developers and users on Linux, and people will still say that they're the best. GOG is awesome.
Multiple things can be true at the same time, right? It's good that there is a place.
We are human,
that,
yes.
Yes. It is good that there is a place selling DRM-free copies of games. Yes. But they don't have to be assholes about it and be like, well, we can be assholes because we're giving away DRM free copies.
Here's the thing, though. I mean, it speaks a lot to here, come back over here, Gabe.
come on, Daddy. Right. I need you. Right. I need your Half-Life juice.
Give me those legs.
It's just the DNA of how Valve is run, like, because you know when you're printing money. Now, I guarantee you, like, if Epic started really getting hurt, or GOG was really, you'd start seeing, like, oh, shit, maybe we need to try to do something with, like, Linux and all these, try these other things. But for Valve to be the company it is, with a fucking money printer, and still go out of their way to have that vision of, like, all right, let's work out a plan here, work this
out. It's like, we have the money to actually think 10 years down the line now.
Well, that's the thing, though. A lot of these guys have the money to think 10 years down the line, but their exit strategy is 9 months down the line.
Short-term profit. Yeah.
So they and
quarterly, baby.
That is the core problem. But maybe you can fix it by installing some hot new software.
Yeah, that's your story.
Yeah.
Malware.
Oh yes. So Malware about Slay the Spire. We were talking about that a little bit earlier because it's crack, it's drugs. I love it. And lots of other people do. There is a mod that adds a new class and additionally lets you play as all of the boss monsters as well in a new campaign. And it's been pretty popular. It's called Downfall. And it turns out that they were distributing their mod outside and via a number of methods. You could download a standalone version of it, you can get it through the Steam Workshop. Regardless, when you launch the game, it'll tell you, like, hey, there's a new version available. Would you like to download it? And like a good user, you've been trained to say, yes, I should install updates because they have fixes. So you click on the link and you get presented with an installer and you go, that seems a little weird. I'm just going to click through it. Lo and behold, all your personal information got scooped. So this is compromised Slay the Spire mod. They had... the actual copy of the binary in Steam wasn't compromised. It was the external link where they post the standalone download client. So if you were just using this through Steam, if you just had it installed via the Steam Workshop, you weren't affected by this. If you're on Linux, you're definitely not affected by this, because if you see a Windows installer on your Linux native game, you understandably go, what the fuck is happening here? And you click out of that and you Google what's going on. But yeah, the moral of the story, and again, us Linux users, we've been trained for this. Trust your package suppliers. Just use the app repo. Use the yum repo. Use the Arch AUR or whatever, right? Like, don't just install it from, like, some random link. You don't know where that's from.
Yeah, no. The like Jordan already said, the compromised version was not on Steam. And I don't know, a few years ago, it's like 2 years ago, Valve introduced the text SMS code that you get whenever you update.
Didn't we talk about it this year? I think it was pretty recent. I don't
know. Look at the swift gentleman trying to bring years into current date argument.
I think it was
2021 that was introduced, or maybe they started introducing it in 2021 and may only have become a more
I think
thing.
That's what it was. It was like mandatory. Yeah. It's becoming mandatory.
It became mandatory this year.
If you wanted to turn your Steam account into a real boy.
Yes,
that's what it was.
If you want to update the binary in your depot, you gotta send an SMS.
Yeah, the main release depot. It requires, whenever you push an update, it requires a text code. So you have to have a registered phone number with your developer account in order to get that code whenever you make the changes. And whoever managed to compromise it didn't get that, so they couldn't compromise anything that was on the Steam store itself. It was external. And yeah, I did some duck going, and about a minute later of just looking for Epsilon malware and Linux, I couldn't find any hits of Linux peeps getting hit with the Epsilon on any form. So people playing on Linux, even if you were playing the Proton version for some reason, you probably in the clear. I've also, never seen the aforementioned Unity pop up to automatically download things. I guess I've never played a lot with mods on Slay the Spire in the 30 or 40 hours that I have in the game.
It seems like a cool mod, honestly. Like, you get to, I like stuff where you get to, like, play as the bosses or the enemy, and, like, you get to.
But it is entirely, from my experience, it is entirely anecdotal, obviously, but it might actually be a thing. Maybe some games will actually let you do that natively on Linux. I just never seen it.
Moral of the story, kids, if you need a Linux and you see a window pop up and it asks you for your root password, don't give it to it.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure one of those DAW plugins you sent me did that at one point.
DAW plugins?
the equalizer, right?
What? No, you needed a registration code for it.
There was something to install.
Yeah. If you're doing a system-wide install, you could have installed it locally. Not had a problem. But anyway, surprisingly, everybody's cool with this. I went and checked their reviews for the mod, and they didn't get review bombs. So I was like, all right, cool. Or they're just blissfully unaware because, you know, I was trained on Windows. Click, 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 click.
Yeah, I mean, this stuff happens. I don't really blame the users. I do blame the mod maintainers for forcing people to go outside the standard chain of trust to get their new version of the software. But... Yeah.
Pedro, tell me about this update to this game, simply because the cover art for this game I've always felt completely oversells.
Oh yeah. A dark wood, like dark wood, both the little artwork they have there in the name.
What is that game, that torture 3D horror porn game?
Blasphemous?
No. Were you in the insane asylum? The first
Scorn?
One. I don't remember. Anyway.
But Darkwood, we've talked about Darkwood. I think we even threw chairs at it at one point. It is a top-down view horror game. It's available natively on Linux. And they've released an update. It's been a while since I've seen any updates for this game. But here they are. I think June was the last one. Update 1.4 brings a ton of bug fixes, so they say, and quality of life changes. The ones that jumped out at me were they updated the Unity version. Yes. They've fixed many issues on Linux. What those issues were, they don't entirely specify, but we can deduce, because then they have the rework control binding sections, which, if you look at what they actually rebound, Those buttons may be for the Xbox One, but they're also the exact same ones on the Steam Deck.
Ha! Found it. That.
Oh, yeah. Outlast, yes.
The 3D.
Breathing. Yes.
Torture porn. Yeah, all right.
Breathing.
The jump scare simulator, yes. And they then have a section about changes for gamepad mode specifically. So, yes, I smell a deck. I think the developer just got a deck and went, oh, this game runs like poo. Let's fix it. So very good, very much appreciate what they're doing, and I wish I could get into it, but
it's that game.
Silent Hill 2 kind of ruined me on horror games.
Top down and follow the mouse when you shoot, and like with a different asset and art pack, and everybody's got their own take on it. Windows users got some DRM added to their build, because apparently you need that for like Steam integration support or something to that effect.
It makes it a lot easier, according to the developer, right, because a lot of the Steam works.
It sounds a lot better than your motherfuckers pirating this thing too much.
I'm sure the pirates are going to keep pirating it. It's fine.
I mean, honestly, they pirated it, played it for 5 minutes, and realized, I got
this is an
Outlast. Yeah, my favorite YouTuber was shouting at this game, so I'm going to try. Oh, no.
Another thing in Jordan's seizure-tastic highlighting spree over here is cloud support, which is awesome. Yes.
It is.
By the way, stop, Jordan. I was enjoying the light show.
I wanted you to be aware of it. I really did. It's very important.
Oh man,
I'm totally not just stimming right now.
Oons. All right, that's gonna do it for the steamy stuff. Let's get into a little bit of news. Starting with we like to run some hardware every now and then. I think this is worth talking about. MicroStar International's first AMD AM5 motherboard and PSU with the ATX12V break cover, which is that new thing that Intel's like, hey, everybody, let's try to do this thing. Like, that's neat, but Intel will probably kill it. Not dead yet. ASUS is also releasing some motherboards that are going to utilize this new standard. Pretty cool, because I like the 12VO standard. I think it's pretty decent, but I'm looking at this motherboard, and Jordan, you'll back me up on this. Maybe Pedro will, too. The lack of PCI expansion holes on these two motherboards. Like, what the hell, man? This has got 1x16 and 1x1.
And an NVMe. It's got two, and no, it's only got the one NVMe. But yeah, like, It is very sparse. That's what I thought of when I looked at that. It's like right. there is a lot of wasted space on this board. But I did a little bit more reading in the article. So this is targeted. This specific motherboard is targeted at OEMs. So the limited ports here are a feature and not a bug. They want you to spend more money for the better motherboard that actually has the holes in it. Mm-hmm. Or you don't get this really cool cover thing that covers up 90% of your motherboard for no reason.
Yeah, that's like a micro ATX almost sized motherboard, and yeah, the
OEM, might as well be an ITX, right?
It's a little too big, but yeah, it is effectively for what it has on it. That is very much what they're targeting, and it probably will be the future, but it's going to leave out a bunch of older hardware. It's just going to drop a cleave in the middle of backwards compatibility, and I don't like it. Hopefully, since, you know, most power supplies and their cats are modular nowadays, might as well, you know, have an option to, hey, if you have a 12VO motherboard, plug this cable in. Mm-hmm. If you don't have a 12VO motherboard, plug this one in. It's like, cool. Yeah.
I mean, it's not going to be too big of a deal, though, man, because you're going to, like, how easy is it to add in card with power adapters on it? Not a big problem. And, like, to your point, modular power supplies, power supply manufacturers, you're going to have these hybrid power supplies that are going to be like, hey, we got the new standard, you just plug it in, let the motherboard take care of it, and by the way, here's a little dinky thing. But it's not like that big of a stretch, because like modern power supplies right now, the ones you have, they're just one big 12 volt rail anyway, man, and what you got is about 120 watts of converters to step down mm-hmm. to your 5 volts and your 3.3 volts. That power supply is not putting that shit out, all right? It's being busted down to that voltage already. That's part of the efficiency loss in these current systems. What this is doing is moving that to the motherboard. Now, you got to think, the motherboard manufacturers probably not really happy about this, but on the flip side, the motherboard manufacturers are going to have a much better idea about the components on the motherboard and the power requirements and what's needed to run it than the power supply manufacturer.
Yeah, but if they're the ones who are going to have to fork over the extra cost, then you get motherboards like that one. Just fucking barren.
You know, and what? Like, here, my strategy, so, Pedro Mateus, is they're not going to have any more money to fucking paint them, and I'm finally be able to get green motherboards again.
Well, and like, how much of this is a timing issue, right? Where, like, I built a computer a couple of years ago. I'm not
that's
in the
mood. Much.
Right. Yeah. I'm not in the market for, like, a new power supply or motherboard or whatever. But, like, in a couple of years, sure. And I think that, like, if you need a new computer in, like, this transitionary period, it's gonna fucking suck. But in, like, 5 years, it's all gonna be all over to the new standard anyways. So, like,
and it's a lot cleaner. I mean, yes, yeah. You're gonna have, like, legitimate issues because your power supplies for your, like, SATA, that's gonna be determined by how many power holes you got on your motherboard, unless you want to, like, start working with add-in cards and all that. But for the vast majority of people, like, I was given this motherboard shit. They know the numbers, man. Like, I'm surprised that motherboard has 4 RAM holes in it instead of just 2.
Wasn't there a picture with one with two, just 2?
Yeah.
Probably.
The 2 one was the OEM one.
Yeah, like 99% of the people building a system right now, GPU. Like, add-in cards are for weirdos at this point. Like who, like, what are you going to do? Like, we've given up SLI, man. So, like, motherboard manager. Yeah,
You bring up SATA. And yeah. Like SATA's going away. NVMe is the thing now. So, like, plug the card.
You still need
Pedro's going to cut you.
That's the thing. You still need the 3.3 volt for idle power on the PCIe ports. You don't really need it for the CPU anymore. It's all sub 2 volt now. So that's the CPU. The power phases around the CPU are going to handle that. The thing you'll actually need is
Pedro, I can put a plug on the back. Look at that.
Yes. The thing you're actually going to need is, oh, what's that? You have 8 USB ports on that motherboard. You're going to need 2 4-pin for the 5 volts to power the USBs. Mm-hmm. Like, oh. Well, that's shit.
Just do it on motherboard. Like,
yeah, but you're going to have to feed that specific whatever is stepping down the 12 volts, I mean, to 5 volts for the USBs. That's
what the power supply is doing anyway. I mean, it's not got a 3-point, it doesn't have it. Everything's a 12 volt rail. It's just been busted down from the power supply.
Yeah, but it's done on the power supply.
Yeah, it's just going to be on the motherboard now.
Yes.
Yeah, we're agreeing violently. I love it. I try to do it at least once every episode.
Don't! Because, yes, we're going to see more barren motherboards with nothing in them because it's a cost reduction and they have to account for the more heat going through the actual PCB of the motherboard instead of being away.
Oh, baby, these are the AM5 motherboards. They're beyond worried about more heat. It's like, what's this thing I let 90 AMDs? Like, that's cool, bro.
That's and, the CPU. That's and, the CPU.
And,
like,
and again, Pedro, you're talking from a very narrow market segment because, again, most of the people are going to be buying these boards. It's gonna be OEM. It's not going to be enthusiasts like us. So they're like, I don't think they're going to care about passing the costs on to the consumer because we're the weirdos who are paying thousands of dollars for this shit anyway.
Because, the cost of the motherboard's not that one that's being highlighted in the article here, but the other one that's coming soon, the cost of having to have the extra power phases to step down, you're going to have to pay for it. Absolutely. Instead of paying $120 for a motherboard, you're going to be paying $140 or $150.
The problem is...
And we'll have no choice because those are going to be the only motherboards available.
Jordan, you don't understand. Me and Pedro buy at least 5 or 6 motherboards a week, so this adds up.
I know. You guys have a problem. I'm trying to stage an intervention, but I can't get through the walls of motherboards. There's too many of them.
No, but I'm dead serious about it because I've been looking around. I desperately don't want to have to build an Epic PC or another HEDT. And we have PCI Express Gen 5 now and Gen 4, and nobody's making these boards. I've like researched. You'll see some like 2x16s. The second one will be a fucking buy one in a 16. Like completely unusable. Like nobody's making like bifurcated, like busted down PCI Express 3.0. And when I see boards like this, I get it, but I grew up when we had 11D PCI holes on just every fucking motherboard and like bonus, like with just smorgasbord. Like even like that B350's got like 3x1s and 2x16s and it's crazy. Neither of you have add-in cards for anything, do you?
I had that,
Black Magic card.
I had the Black Magic card and the adapter for Firewire. Yeah.
SATA.
That was it.
Or those like buy one, two, probably, right?
Yeah.
They are.
I just want to buy 16 and a buy 8. We got the lanes for it, man, but nope.
Micro ATX, like the size of that motherboard, that's a micro ATX board. They could have easily fucking fit the second one.
We shouldn't have let them ever get rid of SLI, man, because back in the day you were guaranteed at least a buy 16 and a buy 8. Now it's just like, really all you need is a hole to put your fucking video card in, right?
Yeah, if you're not using the fucking iGPU on your APU, right? Like, right. Or
dude, all right, let's talk about some moon magic, ladies and gentlemen. OpenDX, Arthurin from Shot Realm sent this in, dropped it into our Discord show suggestions. Open source DirectX alternative for Linux, fully featured implementation of DirectX without the need for a compatibility layer or emulators. Oh man, I miss my wine is not an emulator. The goal here is to provide native DX implementation, as I said, something developers can target. Okay, this is neat. And they kind of do a little victory lap. Hey man, DX diagnostics, we got that up and running, and apparently it runs faster than it does through not running it that way. Okay, neat.
And it's slow as shit on Windows. I'll be real.
Like, all right.
You run that and it takes enough. Like 5 minutes.
Now, I like this idea, but how hard of a sell is this going to be now and coming into 2024 when we got Wine and Proton as like good enough TM to like release a gaming handheld around that model? Like, yeah, well, it's good enough to release a gaming system more.
Beyond that, you can just directly link against DXVK these days. They provide DXVK native. So if you want to have DirectX 11 support, you can just do it. But like, I don't know, for systems that don't have Vulkan, this provides some level of DirectX support. And it also, I don't know, from a long-term perspective, it makes sense to have a implementation of DirectX that is not tied to Vulkan in case something happens to Vulkan vis-a-vis like licensing or I don't know. The Vulcans show up and they're like, just you're not allowed to use it anymore.
Vulkan going down the wrong fucking alley, taking the wrong turn. Like, what the fuck happened to Vulkan? We can't.
Oh yeah, it's covered in like tattoos and it's like strung out on heroin. Listen, I can't pretend to know the future. Spock might take a turn and he might be a little rough by the end of it. But again,
issue there comes not from the Vulcan side, but from the DirectX side.
The
how do you even start with this? This is very light on details. At least I couldn't find Pedro. Help me out. Has this been reversed?
Yeah, they're very much just starting. They can get DX Diag to run. That's it. it is basically implementing libraries locally on a machine on Linux, obviously, that can talk DirectX and just do all of whatever conversion it needs to do and just get it to talk to the GPU, which makes a lot of sense if we're talking about like maintaining compatibility, like Jordan already said, with older machines that don't necessarily support Vulkan, which most of them don't.
Oh, like a Raspberry Pi. Wait, no, never mind. I was going to say
if you have an R600 card, like a 6870 or even an R300 or older Intel, like pre Haswell.
Oh, no.
Ivy Bridge and lower, Vulkan is very, very
true. You're going to wish this we're going to be watching YouTubers with their vintage Linux gaming rigs in a decade.
So there may also be situations where, like, Vulkan performs poorly on a card, but DirectX doesn't.
Vulkan is incapable of performing poorly. How dare you?
I'm just going to
start white-knighting Vulkan for no reason.
VKD3D on
Pascal.
You're going
to take off the glove and slap me in the face, challenge me to pistols at dawn? Yeah.
Down. Let's go.
All right, we're doing it Highlander style.
I can find, like, the Castrol Honda Superbike games. I know, it's one of those me games. Not a lot of people are playing it, but...
The Motor Oil bike game?
Yeah.
Yes. They had a few games that they released in, like, 1998, 97. Those games just don't work with Wine, with the XVK. It doesn't matter. They just... don't work properly. And it would be nice if something like this would also introduce that compatibility to those older versions of DirectX, which makes a lot of sense if there's a place that you want to start with, since we already have DXVK for DX 10 and DX 11 and DX 9. We have D8VK for DirectX 8 and VKD3D for DirectX 12, then yes, let's have something that starts by providing that support for the older DirectX and then move up and have all of that natively implemented. It's probably a good way to start.
Can we call it DOSBox?
You're running an entirely different operating system at this point, which is exactly what they're trying to avoid.
I want, Mateus.
either way, I don't think, and like Wine has their own DirectX implementation stuff going on. I don't think there's a problem with having like more than one project trying to implement this, right? Because like it expands the knowledge base.
Linux is not about having choices.
Yeah, you're right. It's not. It's about installing.
We need a monoculture of DirectX compatibility.
Well, it's a monokernel. Everything's built into the kernel, right?
Yes.
It's not a microkernel, so it's a monolithic kernel. So yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, up next is a piece of Jordan's childhood blood and magic adventure game. Look at that.
Not an adventure game, real-time strategy. I will take games I never actually figured out how the fuck to play for 300, Alex.
So that's 1993 through about 95, 96. We had a good run of PC games, even with the manual. It could be kind of spotty sometimes.
Where it's like, oh, wait, I need to do this the entire time? And you told me this where?
I needed to call
the 800 number to talk to a dev for him to tell me, right?
Seriously, like PC games of those eras, I think anybody who was like of age at that time in that PC gaming era, you had at least one game. It might not have been yours. It might have been a family game that you just fucked off with. You're like, I don't know. I could get to this point, and you just never knew. There was no internet.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So I had several of these games, one of which for me was Blood and Magic, which was a real-time strategy game that Interplay got the rights to, and they slapped the AD&D Second Edition Ravenloft logo on it. It doesn't really have anything to do with it.
Do you
want to
call 100 Interplay and see where it goes?
The number you're trying to reach has exploded.
That's when you reach Atari. Oh, no, that was Infogrames. Never mind.
it was a real-time strategy game. You build up your blood, you use it to make golems and shit, and you attack other wizards. I got this on the Forgotten Realms Archive Silver Edition. This is the first disc that had all like the SSI Gold Box games on them. I don't have the decoder wheels anymore. But yeah, like it's cool. I haven't thought about this game in literally decades. And it's cool to see that there's an open source version of it now. It is just the demo, but this could be like reverse engineered and yeah, blood and magic.
Apparently it's abandonware.
Yes.
All right. Producers on Tachyon Studios.
It is Interplay. Yes.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's what it says on my CD-ROM over there. So I don't know. I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah, no, I like the readme on their GitHub repo is just the readme that came with the demo. They just pasted that. It was like, there you go. There, done.
Trying to find some photographic evidence of this thing. And here we go.
There it is.
Maybe.
That's about what it looked like. Yeah.
All right. So Fantasy Dune 2.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. That very much like style of game.
It was like a fucking generic ass RTS that they slapped the AD&D logo on because Interplay had the rights to publish it.
Okay. And what is this? All the sources, and this is just for the interactive demo, I guess I should point that out. Originally for DOS, this is mostly C++. So it shouldn't take a lot of heavy lifting to get this over.
Some assembly.
Yeah, some assembly required, no joke. It's got the old school, really shouty code base .cpp, which everything is in caps, period. Well,
that was DOS back in the day.
That
right?
was a standard, like, man. Like that. Yeah. Like, but you I was browsing through sources, like this entire fucking repo shouting at me. Like,
yeah. Back when that caps lock had an actual function on your computer. Right.
Goodbye, Hydra.
The eye of Hydra. Yes. they've released Hyper Rogue.
Get rid of my Hydra cufflinks.
Goodbye, Moon Man.
Surprise, you're not wearing them.
These aren't even Hydra. They're just little octopuses.
The version 13.0 of Hyper, not Rouge as it says in the show notes, but Hyper Rogue is out.
Yeah, it is the fucking play, Mulan Hydra.
They've introduced some new weapons, including the crossbows, 27 different species of
the crossbow was the one weapon they introduced.
One weapon is yeah. just the one weapon yeah
it's just okay. the one weapon.
I looked at it and I'm like, okay, this is one of those hyperbolic viewpoint navigation games, and I like to think that I have a good sense of direction. I do. I genuinely do. I can use an analog watch, just working one, preferably, and from the position of the sun and get a general sense of where north is just with those two things.
Minesweeper.
yes.
Might as well be, as much as I understand how to fucking play Minesweeper.
Once you... start introducing hyperbolic and non-Euclidean, and this one is very, very hyperbolic in its navigation. Games like that fuck with me in spectacular ways. And I saw a video of someone playing this, and I'm like, oh god.
So if you go back and read a lot of like H.P. Lovecraft's like fantasy world works, he talks a lot about like people existing in non-Euclidean geometries. So mm-hmm. like this is basically this game is living life like a fucking Lovecraft character. I don't know how to fucking explain.
I mean, he's got a good explanation of like Thurston mm-hmm. geometry, but I'm like, where's your fucking gameplay video here? Oh, here we go. Steam. Maybe. Yes. Hey, now it's in VR, bitches.
In VR, yeah.
Still no idea what's going on, but
it's a roguelike. You can tell like the character is not moving in squares or in hexagons.
So's Monopoly. Shapes. I don't understand how to do that either, Pedro. It doesn't help me out.
It is very much it plays the traditional roguelike way. But yeah, no, the perspective, the hyperbolic perspective, it messes with my brain.
Yeah, I tried this as well, and It's one of those things where like you could get into it if you're like really into this kind of stuff. If it tickles you, it'll probably grab you and suck you into its non-Euclidean world.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's going to wrap it up before the news. But if you want to get in contact with us, you want to reach out and touch somebody, we make that extraordinarily easy. Just like that. Because that's supposed to not be docking, but it is.
Hold on. I got to twerk 1 second.
Great value. head over to linuxgamecast.com. We got a contact form. If you want to shout, scream in our direction, tell us what's going on. You got some questions for us. That's the best way to do it. YouTube comments, leave us a message on Patreon. However you want to do it, just don't hit us up on social media and expect us with our little squirrel memories to remember, because we surely won't. And if you do that, we just might read about it on this very show, like Bruce.
Bruce! Man, I loved you in Jaws. You were my favorite character. Bruce says, hey guys, new caller and listener. With all the Steam Deck buzz, devs finally going to show Linux some love in 2024? Or are we stuck with indie gems and retro throwbacks?
Porn games. You forgot the porn games.
That's retro. Yes.
I mean, yeah, depends on, I don't know. That depends how much bush they have.
They were only able to license their first album.
Ah, yes.
Pretty limited.
Indeed. I don't know. I think the Steam Deck existing is definitely giving developers a reason to take another look at supporting Linux. If not by directly producing Linux binaries, then at least making it run nice in Proton, right?
I think that's going to be the crux of it. I mean, because what we're asking here is, like, will we see anybody in 2024 release a native? Now this, I guess that comes with, like, a Valve difficulty multiplier, because I could see somebody like Gabe, like, hey, make this native for the Steam Deck. I want you to squeeze all the fucking performance out of it, because I kind of want to show off, like, hey, this can run on the fucking deck really well, and like slide in a dump truck full of money.
Yes. Over to a developer. But as soon as that money stops, no more.
Well, I mean, look at Quake 2 RTX. That's still being maintained, right?
Right.
But that was Nvidia, though.
Here's to what Jordan's saying is, like, the developers are in a position of, like, well, we don't really have to do anything and it kind of works. So, like, why would we want to change that formula? You're giving us money. We're not seeing the.
It's the zero effort barrier of entry that Proton currently offers.
Yeah, you know what? Like, leave us a comment on this video. Let's know what you think. Like, will somebody finally, because it has not happened yet. We've not. Since the Steam Deck's release, unless I'm incredibly not right, we've not seen a AAA title come out with Linux native support.
Nope.
I thought maybe Baldur's Gate, but no, not gonna happen.
No, Baldur's Gate was Larian.
They begrudgingly ported Divinity 2. So.
And it was Divinity Original Sin 1, and it ran fucking great.
Yes.
And it was done like purely in OpenGL. But I will say BG3 does have like a Vulkan render mode, and that runs great under Linux. Pedro, they did their diligence.
Pedro, if you had to take a guess, though, if you wild guess, all right, one from everybody. AAA title, what studio and what's going to be the game in 2024?
Considering how proactive they were in making sure that EAC ran on the deck when. Valve and Epic made it effectively the tick of a box, get a file, put it in the right place in the depot. EA, they're probably going to release, it might be one of their like indie quote unquote efforts, but it might be like EA.
Jordan.
Since nothing is riding on this bet, I'm going to go for the reach. I'm gonna say someone at Nintendo has a brain altering stroke that makes them realize how great Linux is and decides to port the new Mario and Zelda to Linux.
I didn't expect you to reach that far, but okay.
Stretch Armstrong, baby. I'm Mr. Fantastic.
This is just like Jordan's going straight for kidnapping and blackmail. He's like, all right.
Yeah, he just has a stroke, right? His brain explodes and he thinks this is a good idea.
Oh, man.
What about you, Ben? Do you have a real answer?
Yeah, if we can pilot this fucking ship back into the atmosphere. After that detour, maybe some from Capcom or Squeenix. I could see
Squeenix.
Comes down to Valve driving that dump truck full of money up, and they really would like people in Japan. They made a big push for Valve anyway, mm-hmm. for the Steam Deck in Japan, like displays, like events for it. Like I could definitely see them coming into Capcom or Squeenix or maybe not Sony, but coming in and saying, hey, you know what, this next Final Fantasy game or whatever.
Well, speaking of Final Fantasy, we know that Square does pay Codeweavers to QA their games.
Mm-hmm.
So, and FF16 is coming to PC next year. So maybe.
That would be my wild crazy. Like, huh.
I mean, Gabe is a big fan of Final Fantasy XIV, yes. He's made no secret of that, and that's like one of the games that he said he wanted to play on a device like the Steam Deck.
And they kind of work now, because, you know, they're turning into action RPGs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Much to the enjoyment of the entire fan base. It's awesome that we all get together. And
yeah, no one hated Final Fantasy XVI. What dude, are you talking dude, about?
We play some Final, then we go home and we watch Spirits Within again. It's dope.
Yeah, it was the Spirits Within characters in Skyrim and nothing in the open world, and everyone awesome. Went, the fuck?
don't listen to this later.
People love the combat in 16, though. Some of the shit you can do is like some next level Devil May Cry.
I mean, yeah, you look at that and you're like, that looks like a fun game to me. Then you're like, no, you need to go back to the real fun. And it's like two static characters going, fuck. Bonk, and I'm like, and they're like, no, this is the shit right here, man. You're just look at bonk.
When people complain about like Final Fantasy moving to real time, they've been trying to do that shit forever. Active time battles was like the first attempt at trying to like bridge the gap between like turn-based Final Fantasy and real-time Final Fantasy by making you pay attention at the time. They always wanted it to be an action game. They were just limited by the platform. And then
they could make the change at that time because, you know, they had a very big fan base.
NES, NES, PlayStation, like the bonks per cycle were pretty fucking low back in the day. So, yeah, you gotta think
about it. Yeah, and you look at stuff like Final Fantasy 11 and 13, where there's like a lot more emphasis on like dynamic battles and whatnot. Even all the way up to 15 and 7 Remake, which are basically action games. You can pause shit.
I want to get into that because I downloaded the demo and played around with Final Fantasy Fabulous Boys on a Road Trip.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever that one was, and like they didn't
15.
They didn't quite have the combat on that, right?
Yeah,
like, you can see what they
that one was still very
to.
Similar to Final Fantasy 12 and 13.
Yeah, I think did you play 7 Remake yet?
No.
From what I've heard, that one is like the better iteration of the 15 combat system.
Okay. Like, see, for me, it's like very clean slate. Like, I know nothing about Final Fantasy outside of just like what I've watched other people's enjoyment from it, like the 2D versions, like the backstory and all that. I don't know, whatever, like long as it's a fun game, that's all I'm looking for. So there we go, you have it here confirmed right here on this very show. We're getting a Final Fantasy native builds for the Steam Deck in 2024.
Sonic the Hedgehog on Linux.
Assuming like people Discord,
that's not even a dark horse. I could see Sega coming out. Dude, all right, Sega with their latest announcement with that bullshit. They're like, by the way, this is all coming out on Steam Deck. I could see Gabe like, hey, dump truck over here,
make it native.
Sega has been like remarkably Linux positive for a Japanese company for like a while.
That's because they're desperate.
But that doesn't matter. We'll take it, baby. It's still sex.
That's the thing. The feral ports and the last anything close to AAA that we got was Total Warhammer.
Mm-hmm.
So it is.
Yeah. Yeah.
It is a solid bet. Yes.
I agree with Monster Cameron. The Yakuza needs to take over Sega again. That's the only way that this shit will work.
LGC cares. choke on your chokiness.
Choke on the garrote that the Yakuza assassin is wrapping around your neck.
The deadly Toronto. So check this out. Hey, if you like what we do and you want to get some exclusive content, some bonus sodas, you like this show, we're about to go into the after show, which... the show ain't over, and you're like, wait a minute, what? I'm like, no, this is just screaming middle. This is like the shortest part of our show on Saturdays. We got the pre-super shows, and we got the pre-show, we got the after shows, and we got Jordan's coughing hour because he took too big of a fucking hit.
and my throat is fucked up from throwing up a bunch. That was the other reason.
I like my way better. You can get access to that by becoming a patron. We got a little support button over there. We got Patreon, we got Libra Pay, PayPal, Bitcoin, but you get all the bonus sodas as a patron. You get access to our Discord, you get the pre super shows, and you get the live stream in video and podcast format, plus behind the scenes stuff and early sneak peeks, snack picks, that stuff we're getting ready to push out. We got Amazon wishlist, we got a merch store, Amazon storefront, and of course a humble affiliate. But I do want to thank Zeno. Got a message.
Chasing that turtle.
Zeno has increased their Patreon pledge. I'm like, that's pretty good. Give a little shout out on the show. Because it, I always look at it because it's a weird, they don't do the currency conversion. It just says from 20 to 30. And I'm like, what? And it's like Kroters. And I'm like, oh, all right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Dope. Thanks, man. I do appreciate it. And yeah, everybody helping us out, making this show possible, doing what we do. And keep an eye out. I'm going to be asking for some QA and some feedback on that Nvidia versus Debian versus people tried to install binary drivers on Linux video. So that you guys are going to get first crack at that. Help me out with it.
Can you out idiot Ven is the question.
Dude, can you come up with new idiot scenarios that I have not? Because I, you know, Nvidia drivers.
Ask the stupidest questions.
Dude, and like we get a lot out of that, and that's better for everybody because that's better guides. Next time somebody's like, hey, I want to do this. And like, oh, look, I messed up the thing. All right, everybody. That's going to do it for 2023. And we're going to forget it's 2024 for a couple of months, but
that's at least the next time that you got to write a check.
Hopefully never, if all goes according to Kekaku. Ladies and gentlemen, if you want to get in touch with me, I'm at Vin Stone on, I think, Twitter. I'm at Ven on Mastodon. I'm at something on Blue Sky.
I think you're at Ven on Blue Sky.
Yeah, I think I'm Ven just there. And yeah, I think that's it everywhere. If you want to get in contact, I'm in Discord hanging out with these guys the rest of the week, doing our thing, singing our song.
I'm Jordan. You can see me back in my dump truck ass up at Frojo at mass.linuxgamecast.com, at Frojo on Blue Sky, and at The Burning Fool on Twitter.
And I suppose you can beg me to sing the song of my people. Good luck with that.
What is that song?
On Mastodon, it's unaccounted for with the actual number 4 at mass.linuxgamecast.com.
I was just seeing what Nightbot was chastising.
No caps.
no cap, babe. Skibbity toilet. Yeah, credits.
I don't want to go outside. I just want to watch Skibbity Toilet. That video has been stuck in my head for a while, and I have no idea why.
You know what? I didn't get audio on it, man, but I finally looked that up, and I'm like, oh, this is the Patient Zero thing. All right, got it.
Yeah, we got to thank Ophagus, our Theranar advisors, executive producers, Barb Bramp, Scott Bashod, Tom McCass, Mike G, Drummer, Tomas, Hakim, David, E. Shep, and Ian. And our little Nicky fan, Super Desto, Empty, Glorious Egg Roll, and Nubbin.
I'm way over here on this shot. I just realized that.
And the sea monsters were no Rider X, Magnus, Reggie, Veritanuda, Justin, Nubbin, Darkwing, System T, Dancing Joe, and Ogi One, and so many Death Notes, starting with Nova, ending with Marco, and Piper, and Jalu, and Svine.
Yeah, live it, Mark.
Now,
Doom2.1, I know he's in there.
We have to thank all the fine upstanding.
It's animals. Raining nubbins.
I want to know, do we have an auctioneer in our audience? Can we get them to try and like read out every chairling as fast as they can?
I think we've looked it up. The Micro Machine guy's dead, isn't he?
Aww. Ooh.
That would have been a great spin for Cameo, right? We're like, read this.
Yeah, as fast as you can.
Yeah. Identify everyone. We'll see you next week.
Next year.
Week year. Oh, dude, yeah, we don't have leap year, we have week year.
Five dudes.